family circle singing loud. Daddy sang bass. Singing seems to help a troubled soul. One of these days, and it won't be long, I'll rejoin them in a song. I'm gonna join the family circle at the throne. No, the circle won't be broken. By and by, Lord, by and by. Daddy sing bass. In the sky, Lord, in the sky. Now I remember after work, Mama would call in all of us. You could hear us singing for a country mile. Now little brother has done gone on, but I'll rejoin him in a song. We'll be together again up yonder in a little while. Daddy sing bass. Cause singing seems to help a troubled soul. One of these days, and it won't be long, I'll rejoin them in a song. I'm gonna join the family circle at the throne. Oh no, the circle won't be broken. Sing bass. In the sky, Lord, in the sky. In the sky, Lord, in the sky.
There's a blue on your windowsill, there's a rainbow in your sky. There are happy thoughts your heart to fill, near enough to make you cry. And if perchance your heart grows sad, you still can smile again. With every tear you've ever shed, comes sunshine after rain. There's a bluebird on your windowsill, there's a rainbow in your sky. There are happy thoughts your heart to fill, near enough to make you cry. Clouds will roll away. Everything will come if you wish it so, as an answer when you pray. There's a bluebird on your windowsill, there's a rainbow in your sky. There are happy thoughts your heart to fill, near enough to make you cry.
sit and talk about old men. If you wonder how long I'll be faithful, I'll be happy to tell you again. I'm gonna love you forever and ever, forever and ever, amen. They say time takes its toll on the body, makes the young girl's brown hair turn gray. But honey, I don't care, I ain't in love with your hair. And if it all fell out, well, I'd love you anyway. They say time can play tricks on memory, make people forget things they knew. Well, it's easy to see, it's happening to me. I've already forgotten every woman but you. Oh, darling, I'm gonna love you forever, forever and ever, amen. As long as old men sit and talk about the weather, as long as old women sit and talk about old men. If you wonder how long I'll be faithful, just listen to how this song ends. I'm gonna love you forever and ever, forever and ever, amen. I'm gonna love you forever and ever, forever and ever.
Savior in. Then Jesus came like a stranger in the night. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. I saw the light, I saw the light. No more darkness, no more night. Now I'm so happy, no sorrow inside. Praise the light. Just like a blind man, I wandered along. Worries and fears I claimed for my own. Then like the blind man, the dark gave back his sight. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. I saw the light, I saw the light. No more darkness, no more night. Now I'm so happy, no sorrow inside. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. Now I'm so happy, no sorrow inside. Praise. I saw the light.
With time, my face has wrinkled, but my blue eyes still sparkle with the love I felt for you the day we met. To me, you're just as lovely as the first time I saw you. Times have changed, but our hearts haven't yet. I'm still the same old me, loving the same sweet you. Time hasn't withered our heart, and when our days are through, I'll still be loving you. Even death can't keep us apart. Now begun to tremble, but when they touch you, the same old feeling's there. But your smile is still as special as it was the day we married. Years haven't changed the love we shared. I'm still the same old me, loving the same sweet you. Time hasn't withered our hearts, and when our days are through, I'll still be loving you. Even death us apart. I'm still the same old me, loving the same sweet you.
Sitting here thinking about some old times, some old times, some old friends, and suddenly it came across my mind, I would like to see you again. Remember how we used to walk and talk, walk and talk. Said we loved each other, I recall. We made a lot of future plans, but the years have come and gone, and a whole lot has happened since then. But tonight your memory's awful strong on my mind, see you again. It's funny how a feeling will come back, it'll come on back, make you blue, 'cause I just saw a picture in my mind about a time. The years have come and gone, and a whole has happened since then. And tonight your memory's awful strong on my mind, and I would like to see you again. Yes, the years have come and gone, and a whole lot has happened since then. But tonight your memory's awful strong on my mind, and I would like to see you again.
I remember when I was a lad, times were hard and things were bad, but there's a silver lining behind every cloud. Just poor people, that's all we were, trying to make a living out of blackland dirt. But we'd get together in a family circle singing loud. Daddy sang bass, singing seems to help a troubled soul. One of these days, and it won't be long, I'll rejoin them in a song. I'm gonna join the family circle at the throne. No, the circle won't be broken. By and by, Lord, by and by. Daddy sing bass. In the sky, Lord, in the sky. Now I remember after work, Mama would call in all of us. You could hear us singing for a country mile. Now little brother has done gone on, but I'll rejoin him in a song. We'll be together again up yonder in a little while. Daddy sing bass. 'Cause singing seems to help a troubled soul. One of these days, and it won't be long, I'll rejoin them in a song. I'm gonna join the family circle at the throne. Oh no, the circle won't be broken. By and by, Lord, by and by. Daddy'll sing bass. In the sky, Lord, in the sky.
Sad, you still can smile again. With every tear you've ever shed comes sunshine after rain.
There's a bluebird on your windowsill. There's a rainbow in your sky. There are happy thoughts your heart to fill, near enough to make you cry.
Wish it so as an answer when you pray.
There's a bluebird on your windowsill. There's a rainbow in your sky. There are happy thoughts your heart to fill, near enough to make you cry.
Mm-hmm.
bluebird on your windowsill. There's a rainbow in your sky. There are happy thoughts your heart to fill, near enough to make you cry, near enough to make you
love that I feel for you always will be. Well, you're not just time that I'm killing. I'm no longer one of those guys. As sure as I live, this love that I give is gonna be yours until the day that I die. Oh, baby, I'm gonna love you forever. This toll on the body makes the young girl's brown hair turn gray. But honey, I don't care, I ain't in love with your hair. And if it all fell out, well, I'd love you anyway. They say time can play tricks on memory, make people forget things they knew. It's happening to me. I've already forgotten every woman but you. Oh, darling, I'm gonna love you forever, forever and ever, amen. As long as old men sit and talk about the weather, as long as old women sit and talk about old men. If you wonder how long I'll be faithful, just listen to how this song ends. I'm gonna love you forever and ever, forever and ever, amen. I'm gonna love you forever and ever, forever and ever.
Blind man, I wandered along worries and fears.
claim for my own. Then like the blind man that God gave back his sight, praise the Lord, I saw the light. I saw the light, I saw the light. No more darkness, no more night. Now I'm so happy, no sorrow inside. Praise the Lord, I saw the light.
My blue eyes still sparkle with the love I felt for you the day we met. To me, you're just as lovely as the first time I saw you. Times have changed, but our hearts haven't yet. I'm still the same old me, loving the same sweet you. Time hasn't withered our heart, and when our days are through, I'll still be loving you. Even death us apart. These hands that once were steady have now begun to tremble, but when they touch you, the same old feelings there. But your smile is still as special as it was the day we married. Years haven't changed the love we share. And I'm still the same old me, loving the same sweet you. Time hasn't withered our hearts, and when our days are through, I'll still be loving you. Even death can't keep us apart. I'm still the same old me, loving the same.
Sitting here thinking about some old times, some old times, some old friends, and suddenly it came across my mind, I would like to see you again. Remember how we used to walk and talk, walk and talk, holding hands. We said we loved each other, I recall. We made a lot of future plans, but the years have come and gone, and a whole lot has happened since then. But tonight your memory's awful strong on my mind, and I would like to see you again. It's funny how a feeling will come back. It'll come on back, make you blue. 'Cause I just saw a picture in my mind about a time of me and you. But the years have come and gone, and a whole lot has happened since then. And tonight your memory's awful strong on my mind, yes, the years have come and gone, and a whole lot has happened since then. But tonight your memory's awful strong on my mind, and I would like to see you.
Remember when I was a lad, times were hard and things were bad, but there's a silver lining behind every cloud. Just poor people, that's all we were, trying to make a living out of blackland dirt. But we'd get together in a family circle singing loud. Daddy sang bass, singing seems to help a troubled soul. One of these days, and it won't be long, I'll rejoin them in a song. I'm gonna join the family circle at the throne. No, the circle won't be broken. By and by, Lord, by and by. Daddy sing bass.
Please be seated. It seems through our life we encounter various storms. Sometimes they're physical storms like wind, but there are also other storms that are emotional, that are spiritual. And I think the words that Jesus gave when the disciples were out on the sea in the middle of the night at 3 o'clock, it says, and the winds were so fierce that they thought their boat was going to sink. And they were terrified. And then they see Jesus coming, walking on the water, and they were even more terrified. But then Jesus gave these words, and he says, don't be afraid. Take courage. I am here. I believe those are the words that Jesus is speaking to you as a family today. It seems like the rug has been pulled out from under us with such a sudden death where you haven't had a chance to say goodbye. And Jesus is saying, don't be afraid. I am here. He loves you. On behalf of Jason and Jennifer, Ryan and Sandra, Brent and Terry Lee and Debbie and Derek and their families, I welcome you to the Celebration of Life service of Jerry Friesen. The family truly appreciates your loving support, your kind words, your encouragement cards, the flowers, and the food that was brought during this time of sorrow and grief. To you as a family, I want to say this. It seems like only such a short while ago when you sat here to say goodbye to Nancy, your mother, your grandmother. And to me, as I reflect on it, it just seems too soon and way too sudden that Jerry has been taken. And in this grief, when it seems too much to bear, may we remember Jesus saying, I am here. Fall on him to experience that inner strength, that inner peace, that inner joy and courage to move forward. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we come to you with mixed emotions. Part of us almost feels like screaming because of our grief, the pain that we feel. And yet on the other hand, Lord, we are rejoicing in the fact that Jerry is with you. We have that assurance because he had put his faith in the Lord Jesus as his Savior. And so we know he is with you and he has been reunited with family and friends who've gone before. But Lord, the rest of us who are here carry that pain and that grief. And so I just pray that the Holy Spirit would just come upon us here, and especially upon the family. May they sense your healing touch. May they sense those words of comfort and those words of hope spoken to them through you, Lord. We ask this in your precious name. Amen. Terry Lee and Ben will now lead us in some singing.
I'll invite you to stand if you are able. If not, that's okay too. You can follow along on the screens or in the hymnals. The number should be on the screen as well. Anybody who knew Jerry well knew how he felt about church music. Hymns all the way. And so we're gonna sing a few hymns in his honor today. And he would be very proud that most of the people up here are family.
The parchments made were every stock on earth a quill and every man a scribe by trade.
For your beautiful singing. You may be seated.
Thank you for leading us in that hearty singing. As we were singing this last song, and I just thought of Jerry with all of his puns that he would put out. And I just imagine what would it have been like for him as he met his Savior? Would he have had some pun in it as well? And I don't mean to be disrespectful, but I can just imagine it could have happened. And he's been welcomed home. I had the privilege of visiting Jerry on his last birthday, which is just a few weeks ago. Had coffee with him in his apartment there and chatted. And he was full of life and excitement, and I had never imagined that that would be my last visit with him. And so it came as a real shock when we got the phone call that Jerry had passed away. But I believe Jerry was known to a lot of people as an encourager. I got to know him as an encourager. Jerry was one who, as I was his pastor for 12 years, he always had our back. He was always one to speak words of encouragement, words of keep going, I believe in you. And I believe that it's safe to say Jerry has encouraged a lot of people over the years. Young people that he had working for him that got their first job through him pumping gas, or even on the school bus with school kids. I can just envision how he greeted the kids and probably made each of their day. And I can see also when he drove the handy van, he was an encourager to people who were in need. He was always looking for somebody that he could help out. But he was a unique person. He had a way of being very direct with his words, as only Jerry could do it. And I appreciated that about him. He always had a pun in it, and sometimes he had to think for a minute how to take it. But I know Jerry had a great heart. He loved his family, he loved people, he loved his church, he loved his Savior. So Jennifer and, or Jason and Jennifer, Ryan and Sandra, Brent and Terry Lee, Debbie and Derek, you've come to know Jesus through your parents' testimony. You've come to understand that there is more to earth, there's more to life than just the things that we do on this earth, but that there is a Savior, a Redeemer, who calls us to live with him, to be with him. And I want to just remind you again of Isaiah 41:10. These are words that were written to Isaiah in his time, but I believe they were recorded for us. It says, "Don't be afraid, for I am with you. Don't be discouraged, for I am your God. I will strengthen you and help you. I will hold you up with my victorious right hand." And that's what God is doing today, and he will do it in the coming days. And I think the 1 John chapter 5, verses 11 to 13 are very appropriate verses, because this is Jerry's testimony. And this is what John says. "This is what God has testified. He has given us eternal life. This life is in his Son. Whoever has the Son has life. Whoever does not have God's Son does not have life. I have written these things to you who believe in the name of the Son of God, so that you may know that you have eternal life." Jerry had that assurance, and I trust every one of us has that same assurance. We will now have the obituary and some tributes, and you will just come up unannounced according to the program.
Hi, I'm Jason Friesen. I'm the oldest of our four kids. The obituary. Jerry was born in Morris, Manitoba on February 1st, 1950, the oldest child of Henry R., or the fifth oldest child of Henry R. and Alma Friesen. He attended school in Rosenort until grade 8, after which he dropped out of school to work at his father's gas station. He met Nancy in Rosenort, and they were eventually married on April 11th, 1970. Jerry took over the gas station from his father in 1976, and it became known as Jerry's Golf. It then became Petro-Canada in around 1985, and then later Rosenort Service Center, and finally ESSO. All of us kids spent many shifts there growing up, and I'll have lots of memories from there. He eventually would sell the business to his son Ryan in 2007. He also spent nearly 40 years as a school bus driver in Rosenort. I missed my spot here. So my mom would eventually be diagnosed with dementia, and as it was progressing, my dad could no longer take care of her, and she was eventually moved into the Red River Valley Lodge in Morris in 2018. Jerry would later sell their house and move to a condo in the Niverville Heritage Center, where he lived for just under a year. The plan was to have Nancy move into the center there as well, in the care facility there, but for various reasons that just did not work out. And Jerry then moved back to Rosenort in 2021 to the Rose Lane Apartments. Jerry visited Nancy faithfully at the lodge every day until she passed away from her disease in May 2023. He loved watching his grandkids and all their sports activities. He liked to curl when he was younger, played many rounds on the golf course, and followed the Jets and Bombers closely. Jerry enjoyed driving and spent the last few years transporting patients in a handy van from Morris to Winnipeg for their weekly appointments. He loved the Lord and was very active at this church here, Rosenort Fellowship Chapel, serving with Nancy as a deacon couple, as head usher, and as a greeter. One of his strengths was meeting new people and interacting with those around him, whether he knew them or not. All he needed to do was say a bit of low German, and that would get people talking to him. Jerry and Nancy enjoyed numerous vacations, going to places like Hawaii and Florida, and many family vacations to the mountains, and also to many trips to Grand Forks. He loved the old traditional hymns and listening to classic country music, the twangier the better, as you heard in some of the pre-show here. And also passed that on to me, probably much to the chagrin of my own family. On Thursday, February 15th, he began experiencing chest pains, and despite the best efforts of first responders and paramedics, he would succumb to his heart disease. Jerry is survived by his son Jason, his wife Jennifer, son Ryan, wife Sandra, son Brent, his wife Tara Lee, and daughter Debbie Wozni with husband Derek. He'll be missed by his 12 grandchildren, Aaron, Reed, Maya, Caden, Trey, Tasia, Emery, Griffin, Santina, Annika, Cruz, and Nash. He's also survived by his sister Betty Clausen, husband Andy, brother Alan Friesen, wife Judy, and sister Karen Peters, and their families. Jerry is predeceased by his wife Nancy, both his parents, Henry R. and Elma Friesen, and his brother Lauren Friesen, sister Irene Siemens, and sister Carol Friesen. Funeral service will be held Thursday, February 22nd at the Rosenort Fellowship Chapel at 2 p.m. Private family burial took place prior to their funeral service at the Rosenort EMC Cemetery. The family wishes to thank the first responders, paramedics, and staff at the Rosenort Rose Lane Apartments. Next is a tribute, so I'll just add a few of mine here, and then my brothers can take over. So, as I said before, I'm the oldest of the four children, and they had me when they were like 20 years old, so we joke that we all grew up together. I enjoyed listening to all the stories from last night, and I could connect, you know, with a lot of them. Like the low German, for example, he could speak it, my mom didn't, but she could understand it, and us kids didn't learn it either, but we at least pick up the key phrases like wo schient it and jomalich and things like that. So just, and just as writing, it's just remembering little moments or day-to-day memories, just listening to Jets hockey games on the radio with them at home or in the car while driving, and made me a lifelong Jets fan as well. Remember supper times, always at 6:30, because that's when he'd get home from locking up at the gas station. Or car rides, when he would practice his swerving on the ice so he's ready for when it really happens. Or seeing how close you get the car to the floodwaters that seem to happen every spring. When my dad took me out driving for the first time, I followed his instructions and found it quite difficult, and told my mom about it, and she said, well, don't do it like your dad. Instead, use just your right foot for both brake and gas rather than his 2 feet method. In a lot of ways, he and I were quite different. I was more like my mom, comfortable to sit and read a book, whereas my dad liked the challenge of being in a room full of strangers. Our last visit together, we had gone out to Smitty's in Niverville, and despite us being the ones having lived there for many years, it was he who knew the people that walked by our table. So he lived in Niverville for about 11 months, and we appreciated having him close by, although it was during the worst of COVID, so we wish it could have been under different circumstances. Just remember how much he loved and supported us. Yes, one more. And I always remember his dedication to my mom. He would faithfully visit her in the lodge every day, even as her memory and health deteriorated. Thank you.
He was supposed to hold it together, so I had a chance. Yeah, reading glasses. Now you all know. Pops, you've only been gone a short time, but I miss you so much already. We were not ready to say goodbye to you so soon after Mom's passing. As a family, have been gathering together these last few days. It has been difficult not seeing at least one parent there with us. For my tribute to the best dad in the world, I want to share some of the things that he has taught me over the last 50 years, and of course, a few memories. He taught me how to treat everyone equally. This includes customers and everyone you meet. You had a huge heart for anyone that was struggling, and you were a very compassionate man. You taught me the value of working hard. You worked very hard to support the family. You came home late some days and always put in a hard day's work and even worked multiple jobs at a time. You taught me to run the business with integrity, honesty, and humility. I'm sure many of you here can remember my dad filling your tires with air or willingly helping you with your vehicles outside in extremely cold conditions. He was a servant to many, and he passed that down to me to strive to do that as well. You taught me how to be an amazing grandpa. I was worried about that line. Glasses don't help. There are no words to express the impact of having Pops and Grammy live across the street from us as we raised our young children. Oh, how we value them. The many times you and Grammy rushed to our house to help us with whatever was needed at the time. Watching our kids board the bus knowing Pops was their bus driver was amazing, to say the least. You showed me what it looks like to support your spouse through sickness and health. The way you stood by my mom's side every step of the way throughout your entire marriage is inspiring. You supported me in so many ways, including coming to watch my sporting events in school. You endured watching me sing in choirs, and you had to even listen to me play the trombone horribly. I remember taking many road trips with the family, as Jason was saying, in the orange and brown station wagon. I'm sure many of you remember that wagon too, especially when we got our drivers. That was a disaster. The princess would be sitting between mom and dad in the front seat, while the three boys in the back seat would be fighting. All of a sudden, dad would reach back while driving and try to pinch any leg he can get his hand on to make us simmer down. We would be moving our legs frantically, hoping his hand would not latch onto our leg. What I would give for another road trip to Grand Forks with both my parents. I will always remember and cherish the rounds of golf. We had together, which usually included lots of laughing, and how many clubs you broke we will never know. I want to thank our dear friends, our church, and extended family. You have supported us throughout my mom's sickness and her passing a short 9 months ago. And here you are again standing beside us during this difficult time. Please continue to uphold us in your prayers as we lean on God to carry us through.
I'm not sure my glasses will work any better than his. So where to begin?
I read two sentences.
I got three words. So to fit into a reasonable time and space, what my dad meant to me is pretty much impossible, but I'll try to give you a glimpse. How do you honor your own dad when he was an integral part of your life and the lives of so many? Why did so many people call him Uncle Jerry, even those that not even related to him? Some people are telling me that he was a pillar in the town, and I don't doubt that after the stories have started pouring in. Back when he owned the gas station, he was often the first person that people would meet when they came to Rosenort. In fact, I met a new friend because my dad told him to go see me at my work. Neither of us had ever met him before, and he came to try to sell me something, and him and I became lifelong friends. So my dad had a way to make everyone around him feel important and loved, as he always took time for everyone. But let me tell you how he touched my life. He taught me so much. He taught me how to work. I started at the gas station when I was 11 in 1988 and had the privilege of working with him until 2007. I've often said that I miss working with my dad and my brother, as that was such a special time in life. He taught me how to have common sense. He taught me not to be afraid to tackle hard jobs. I cannot count how many times him and I pulled something apart and then worked side by side to repair it and get it back together. He taught me not to judge others, which he obviously learned from his own mother. I remember Grandma Friesen very well. It's exactly like that. He taught me not to take life too seriously. His humor was infectious and a huge part of his life. He taught me the importance of having faith and how important it is to attend church regularly. He also taught me the importance of hymns, but I'm not sure I was ever able to teach him the importance of praise and worship music. He taught me the importance of volunteering your time to help others, which he did so much of, from driving the handy van 1 to 2 times a week to the MCC thrift store, to helping his Aunt Tina when she needed it, being able to go back to the lodge and helping there, to being on the palliative care board, and on and on and on and on and on. Him and I did so many things together. We often watched the jets and the bombers together, and he just loved having us over to watch. I offered to take him out for his lunch on his birthday 2 weeks ago, but he wanted me to come over rather, so he could make me lunch. I didn't understand why at the time, but I guess it makes a bit more sense now. He coached me hockey when I was younger, which was definitely a highlight for me. He taught me how to golf, and most of the time, he was actually the only reason I would even go at all. He taught me to love old country music, just like my brother Jason. And we would often tell each other the new songs we would find so that the other could enjoy them too. We would just sit and listen to Wilf Carter. Oh, he liked yodeling. He liked yodeling. I got to go to the Carmen Fiddle Festival with him and my grandpa a number of years back. I was by far the youngest guy there, but I enjoyed it as much as they did. We listened to Merle Haggard, George Jones, Don Williams, and so on. He'd often drop by my work just to drop off goodies, tuchas, just to see how things were going. He got me interested in owning a business. His love for his own employees and customers was evident every day as being with people fueled him. He loved everyone, and I believe that everyone loved him. He showed me that over and over. No matter where we traveled as a family, he would always bump into someone that we knew, and then he would take the time to visit. I feel like we were in California and he found somebody there that he knew. Is that right?
Could easily be.
I think so. If he didn't know anyone in the place we were at, it wouldn't be long before he's visiting with complete strangers who just became his friends. I think that one of his favorite things was to bump into children that could talk Ploteach. He would always start with, if I'm saying it right, Costa Deech. That's the first thing he'd say to the kid, and then as soon as they'd start talking, it was just like the two of them would just chatter. Their faces would light up and they would sit and make jokes with each other. Ploteach was definitely a highlight for him, whether it was in conversation or music. There's many references in my own life that I actually don't have any English words for, and I don't speak Low German, He was very supportive and encouraging to my family and me, and would check in on us frequently like he did so many people. He would help me whenever I needed it, as he was always happy to help. Sometime this past January, I asked him in the middle of the evening, out of the blue, to help me pick something up at work. He just dropped whatever he was doing and jumped into my truck and came along, no problem. Later on, when I got home, I'm like, who does that? Well, he did. He just, whatever, yeah, sure, I'll come. He showed me how to love my kids and how to love my wife, right until the bitter end. He showed me what in sickness and health really means. To speak of how he loved my mother would take a full day, as he was loving and kissing her till the very end. Those last 5 years of my mother's life was very hard on him and our whole family. How blessed I was to have had him for my dad. To have a retired father around is one of the best things in the whole world, and I wouldn't trade our time together for anything. I only wish it was longer and that we could sit longer, that we could hang out together again. The hole in our hearts and in our lives is very, very large, but we know that with the love of God, we'll pull through. We'll always love you, Pops. Goodbye. Goodbye, Dad.
Since I'm much less emotional than Debbie, then I'll read hers as well. Debbie will always have the fondest memories of her Pops. He was absolutely the biggest supporter at all his kids' sporting events. Mom and him rarely missed a chance to watch us play. Debbie considered herself lucky to have her dad able to drive bus for her entire school life. She will cherish those memories of Pop saying, "Good morning, sunshine," and winking at her in the bus rearview mirror. She felt like she learned so much from him. His ability to love and accept anyone from any walk of life was remarkable, as was his ability to tease or nerk you. If he couldn't put a smile on your face, nobody would be able to. He made us laugh until the tears were flowing countless times. His hugs, kisses, and affectionate personality will be greatly missed. What she wouldn't give for one more smooch on the cheek from him. He seemed to touch everybody's life that he came in contact with, whether it was family, old or new neighbors, staff at my mom's lodge, his kids, friends, workers, customers, and even strangers. He would say a couple of words in Ploteach and the conversations would be rolling. We never understood as kids how we could be walking through the grocery store, going to a Jets game, or even riding an elevator in a Florida hotel, and someone would say, "Hi, Jerry." Florida, yeah.
Florida, not California.
It really is impossible to sum up in a couple of paragraphs how much Pops meant to Debbie. She will miss the heartfelt and somewhat cheesy poems, memes, and screenshots that he often texted. The world is now missing a gem.
Rearrange myself. Okay. How wonderful to see you all here. And hello to family and friends online as well. My name is Karen Peters. I am Jerry's younger sister. And I'm going to attempt to pay honor and tribute to my crazy, wonderful, loving brother. Since Jerry was 12 years older than me, I didn't really have memories from growing up years. Childhood memories can be wonderful, of course, but I got to grow close to my brother through the years. I remember being at his wedding at 9 years old, and shortly after that, Jason came along, and since we lived close by, I babysat often for them. I also went on trips with Jerry and Nancy, helping along, and getting the benefit of a vacation with them. He was always calling Nancy his two-door hardtop. I know that doesn't make sense to any of you, but terms of endearment. That's what I would call it. I hadn't heard that phrase yet here, like yesterday. And most of us experienced those terms of endearment. I remember Jerry and Nancy rededicating their lives to Christ early in their marriage, which set their path with their Savior, living a life that shifted their focus to things of God, church involvement, and raising their children to love Jesus. Jerry was my comfort zone and also drove me crazy at times, sometimes with his shenanigans. I was like Jerry with all the crazy things he would say, but making me laugh at the same time and adding a lot of joy to our lives. Jerry was happy and confident with who he was. Jerry took seriously the verse about helping widows because he was on that, slipping me cash, giving deals on gas. That really helped me out. He loved on my kids, and they really benefited from his love and concern, and just the person he was to them. My son Joel told me after a recent gathering, because he had recently got married, "You treat Zoe as good as I treat my Nancy." There was no joking there, just some serious advice. I was there visiting Nancy with Jerry and saw and experienced the love and care he took with her. He was so dedicated to taking care of her in the best possible way. What I also seen from Jerry was, don't take life too seriously. Do what you can to help others, and even though he himself was lonely, he ministered and alleviated loneliness for those he came in contact with. The last week of his life, he drove people for dialysis appointments or treatments in Winnipeg, and I'm sure they would have had a good few laughs along the way. Last summer, I spent a few days with him and in his apartment there, and when we were on his golf cart, we never passed by not one person without a word or two or more. Jerry was an extrovert. His energy and happiness came from spending time with people. Not necessarily those he knew well and loved, not just those people, but strangers and acquaintances, as was said. His jokes and quips and nicknames came easily, and he enjoyed endearing names for most everyone. One of the nicknames we had for him was Uncle Dewey. And I'm sure many of you, or we called him this too, have been called Weasel at one time or another. Our last time together, we had supper in Winnipeg with Jerry and Dolores, Ellen and Judy, and my daughter Allison. I was able to hug him and let him know that I was happy for him in his decision and the direction his life was going with Dolores. Dolores, thank you for shining so brightly in Jerry's life. He told me he was truly, I don't even know what I wrote there. Yeah. Jerry could be serious, of course, too, and capable of those conversations as well. It's hard to imagine our lives without you in it. I know that where you are is where God has put in our hearts to be. Eternity is in our hearts. People want to live to forever, and they can through life in Christ. Okay, so my sister, who couldn't be here, Betty, she's the oldest in our family from Vernon, BC, also mentioned that she wanted to be here but was not feeling well at this time. She sends her thoughts and prayers to the family and remembering many times spent when she came to Rosenort cooking with Jerry and visiting the family. She also mentioned the recent trip traveling with Ellen and Judy and Jerry up to Swan River for Joel and Zoe's wedding being a highlight recently. From Ellen and Judy, it's tough to put together in a few words the many years that we grew up together. From Jerry teaching me how to drive a car, his 55 Chevy, which was, looking back, was amazing, to attending sports events and playing golf together. We worked together for many years, says Al, which will always be known as Jerry's Golf. never an unkind word in all the time we worked together, which showed his gentle spirit. Except when a piece of machinery didn't work as expected, but that usually got resolved with a couple of good hammer blows and we moved on. Even that was done with his sense of humor. He didn't only watch sports, but he enjoyed playing most sports as well. Al says he's the only guy I've ever met or golfed with that could shoot right or left. High school football, seen him break his leg because of it, but Al said he could see, and his children and grandchildren have benefited from this sports gene. Jerry had a quick-witted response for any situation and had everyone in laughter. The last number of years were particularly hard for Jerry and family as they dealt with Nancy's illness. Jerry kept positive and provided exceptional care for Nancy. Jerry also had a positive outlook, and that showed his strength, his true strength of character. I treasure the time we spent together during our scheduled FaceTime with my other siblings. We do that every 2 weeks. And also going out for dinners and planning family get-togethers with Jerry and Dolores. Jerry will be truly missed for the family you have, the precious memories of a kind and loving father and grandfather, which will hopefully carry you through this time. Rest in peace, dear brother and friend. Thank you.
I remember when I was a
lad. We're all gonna miss Pops very, very much, and for good reason. A reason being, he always had time for his grandchildren, no matter what day and what time of the day. It also seemed like making us laugh was one of his favorite things to do, and for good reason, as he was extremely good at that too. Watching Jets and Bomber games with him is, and other family members, something I'll always remember as well. Another fond memory I have of him. And spending time talking about sports is something that I will always remember too. Another one of his passions was golfing and golf cart riding. He was very generous with us, letting us use the cart during the summer to drive around town. And every summer he would take us to the golf course to make sure that we could get a round in with him. And I remember specifically this one time he just took me by myself. We played around and we ate at the restaurant after. I remember having a lot of fun doing that. And he would always make sure to text us on our birthdays every year, and that was very special to me. Something else I remember in my much younger days is that we would go over to his house, and we would split logs with his log splitter. It's just the little things that really stand out to me sometimes. And yeah, I will cherish all these memories in my heart, and we'll miss him very much, but I am thankful to know that I will get to see him again one day.
By and by, Lord, by and by, Daddy will sing bass.
The way he supported my talents and passions was like no other. Most of the time, he was the first one to congratulate me on one of my achievements. I will also always remember the many golf cart rides he took me on, especially the ones I didn't know if we were going to make it back in one piece or not. But deep down, I always knew I could trust him.
One of my favorite memories of Pops is when he would come into a co-op when I was working there, and he would distract me for a long time and talk to all my coworkers, and yeah, I just really liked his ability to make friends with anyone. And yeah, I love you, Pops.
He talked about honor and things I should know. Then he'd stagger a little as he went out the door.
I've always had a lot of fun driving around in the golf cart with Pops, where he'd go so fast and make sharp turns that we'd almost like fall off the back.
And those were Williams boys, they still mean a lot to me. Hank in Tennessee.
One of my favorite memories is when Pops lived in Neverville and we would go over to his apartment and play bocce ball in the yard in front of his apartment. Miss you, Pops.
So what do you do with good old boys like me?
My favorite memory of old Pops was when after Christmas I got hockey cards and he was showing me like the player's stats and riding his golf cart.
Smell a cave jasmine through the window screen.
My favorite memory of old Pops is making bonfires together and riding on his golf cart together.
With Thomas Wolfe whispering in my head.
Pops was one of the most friendliest people. He would talk to everyone, even if he didn't know them. He'd make the best popcorn cake, which I asked for every year for my birthday. But a memory that sticks out to me the most is one we shared recently. I ran into him at the mall, and I didn't expect we'd be talking for over an hour. He gave me some really great advice, and I did the same. I learned so much about him as a person, and I will cherish that forever. I will forever miss you, Popsy.
So what do you do with good old boys like me?
One thing that I will cherish forever is his hugs. If anyone knows Pops, especially us grandchildren, they know that when we're going in for a hug, we're gonna be smothered with love for at least 2 minutes. But I wouldn't change those big hugs for the world. They mean so much to me. I'll miss you so much, Pops.
But I was smarter than most, and I could choose. Learn to talk like the man on the 6 o'clock news. When I was 18, Lord, I hit the road. But it really doesn't matter how far I go. I can still hear the soft southern winds in the live oak trees. And those Williams boys, they still mean a lot to me. Hank in Tennessee, I guess we're all.
I'm sure as you are listening to this right now, you can look around and see how many people Pops had impact on. He showed love to everyone and showed kindness to everyone, no matter if he spoke Low German or not. And you found out pretty quickly if he did. One thing that I will never forget about him is how much he loved his wife and how much he showed that to others. He was not afraid to, and yeah, he was there for her through thick and thin, and he was there through thick and thin with us as well. I'm going to dearly miss him and miss his jokes, miss his kisses, miss his hugs, and just miss his love.
Trying to find the courage to ask her out was like trying to get off from a water spout.
My name is Caden, and I am the oldest grandchild of Jerry. I called him Pops all the time. Pops was a very important person in my life. As early on as he drove me to school, we always did things like watch sports together. We did road trips to Swan River together. We did lots of amazing things together. He also shared a lot of very valuable life advice with me, like some things with like how to deal with customers when working at the gas station and when I was working at the shop. He also taught me about anger management when dealing with sports, especially if you're like watching like a Jets game or a Bomber game. He said that if the refs were getting out of hand, which according to him, the refs were always getting out of hand against the Jets or the Bombers. He said what you can do is that you can take a pen and you can throw it against the TV as hard as you want, which is totally fine because the TV won't break from the pen. So another thing is that if you're golfing, and if you've ever golfed with Pops, you know that sometimes golf can be a very very frustrating sport. So he said that you can smack a golf club on the ground, you can hit whatever you want, but just do not hit a tree with a golf club. It's just too dangerous to do that. I asked him if it was okay if I hit a bench with a golf club. He said, yep, that's no problem at all. He taught me in life to not take life so seriously, and to enjoy the people around you and always try to be a fun and bubbly person for everyone else. So he's going to be missed dearly, and I'm not sure how we're going to live without him. It's going to be a little bit dull since he had such a fun, big personality. So we'll miss him dearly.
Well, we've had a quick journey through the eyes of family of the life of Jerry. Now, Trey, do you want to recall? Do you want to have another opportunity? For some reason, we didn't get it. You okay? All right. Before Pastor Darrell comes and gives a devotional, I will just read the passage of Scripture that he will be speaking out of. It's Galatians chapter 2, verses 15 to 20. And I'm going to read it out of the New Living Translation. It says, "You and I are Jews by birth." That's Paul talking to the Apostle Peter. He says, "We are Jews by birth, not sinners like the Gentiles. Yet we know that a person is made right with God by faith in Jesus Christ, not by obeying the law. And we have believed in Christ Jesus so that we might be made right with God because of our faith in Christ, not because we have obeyed the law. For no one will ever be made right with God by obeying the law. But suppose that we seek to be made right with God through faith in Christ, and then we are found guilty because we have abandoned the law. Would that mean that Christ has led us into sin? Absolutely not. Rather, I am a sinner if I rebuild the old system of law I have already torn down. For when I tried to keep the law, it condemned me. So I died to the law. I stopped trying to meet all of its requirements so that I might live for God. My old self has been crucified with Christ, and it is no longer I who live, but Christ lives in me. So I live in this earthly body by trusting in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself up for me."
I can still hear you talking downstairs. It's a little bit of delay there. What an amazing man is Jerry. Tributes and stories like we've heard today always make me regret not knowing the person more. And it's also very telling of how wonderful a person is when you look at the children and the grandchildren. And that tells me a lot about the man himself. This morning, as we committed his body to the ground, there were some markers so that the family could write on the casket little messages and things that they would like to say as they lowered the casket into the ground. And I thought of something. I didn't think it was my place to write on the casket, but I thought this is what I would have written to Jerry. Ikonik dich verstohn. Bet ich live die. You know, if for those of you who don't know Low German, that means I don't understand Low German. That's what I would have written. Then I said to Marianne, who is standing next to me, I don't know how to print that. So she said, it doesn't matter, no one will see it. We have mentioned often that Jerry's death has come as a shock to many of us, and when someone is dying of a sickness, and it is a long and painful event, we are even then taken aback by their death. It still shocks us. It still hurts us. But there is this opportunity to perhaps say goodbye or to have some final words. In Jerry's case, we're even more taken aback because Jerry was simply living life as usual, and his sudden death has taken us by complete surprise. And I can say this confidently, I know Jerry's children are still reeling from this event, having to say goodbye to another parent. And again, this has been said, their mother's funeral is only a short time ago, 9 months ago. And having to deal with grief again is so hard. They didn't expect to be grieving over Pops, as they called him. In conversation with you as a family, I sensed that there was no chance to say a proper goodbye. There was no opportunity to say, I love you, or to say, I'm going to miss you. And yet, at the same time, I didn't hear any regret that the last words you said were anything that you would feel bad about, that there were sentiments unsaid. There is a very strong sense in which you felt loved by your dad, and you knew you loved him. And he loved you. Oh, he loved you. I can see that. We knew it. But with no chance to say goodbye, we are left wondering, what was the last thing that I said to Jerry? What is the last thing you said to Pops? And I know that for myself, the last thing I said was, happy birthday. I texted this to him. Happy birthday. I hope that you feel surrounded by love, by the love of your family. And he texted back and said, thank you, Daryl. And that's the last thing. I knew that my next thing was going to be, when can we go for breakfast again? The fact that death sometimes is so sudden and gives us no warning, leaves us no chance for last words, leaves us with the idea that maybe we ought to be careful of what we say to people when we leave. Are we encouraging them? Are there words of anger? Does it matter what our last words are? If poorly chosen words escape our lips before we die, does this disqualify us from God's eternal life in Jesus? If I recall correctly, when my car was colliding into a car that had come into the middle of my path, I did not cry out, Jesus, help me, but rather, oh, shaving cream. Does that negate my faith? What would Jerry have said? The reason I ask this is it comes from an experience I had with Jerry. I had asked a question about following Jesus. Sharon and I actually met with Jerry and Dolores, and I didn't know Dolores, and so I asked her quite pointedly. I said, are you a follower of Jesus? And she said, yes. And Jerry interjected and said, yes, sort of, kind of, you know. And I don't know if he was being narcish, and maybe he was trying to get at me, trying to do something there with maybe a little humor. I don't know, because I was getting to know Jerry, but I didn't always know when he was joking. But there was a sense, not that he didn't have faith in Jesus, but that perhaps he struggled, or perhaps he wrestled with his own feeling of commitment. Was I committed to Jesus as much as I should have been? You know, he knew that he hadn't been in church consistently. And perhaps he felt maybe he wasn't the poster boy for sainthood. I don't know. And I know that the long and agonizing experience of watching his beloved wife slip down the black hole of dementia challenged his faith. I know that. I sat with him when I first met him. And you've heard about how lighthearted he was and how fun-loving he was, how joyful he was. And I was surprised when I sat down with him for the first time and saw the sadness in him and the bitterness at having been denied by COVID the chance to be with his wife in those moments. Well, when our faith is weakened by life's trials, is weak faith enough? Well, much faith is needed to be accepted into God's rest. I want to talk about faith for a moment. What is faith? The writer of the book of Hebrews tells us that faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the conviction of things not seen. In other words, and I want to put this in my own words, we are sure that we hope, what we hope for is going to be realized someday, even if we can't see how or when it will come to be. But we're sure. We don't know how or when, but we are sure. Faith is not dependent on me willing something into being. No matter how much I pinch my eyes and will it with all my strength, I can't make it happen. Faith in God is believing that He will do what I cannot with a power that I do not have and in a timing that I have to put my trust in God's sense of timing. What do we hope for? We hope for a day when we can eat chips and drink Pepsi without worrying about our health. Right? We hope for a day when dementia will not steal our loved ones' memories. We hope for a day when Christ will return and He will make all things right in the world. But we need faith. We need to believe that God can bring about this day. And the writer of Hebrews also says, without faith it is impossible to please God, for whoever would draw near to God must believe that He exists and that He rewards those who seek Him. Does it say how much faith we need? How much faith do we need? You know, Jesus said, if you have faith the size of a mustard seed, you can move mountains. That's a pretty small amount of faith. That's a very small seed. And the man who approached Jesus about his ailing son honestly confessed that he wanted to have faith, but he asked Jesus to help him with his unbelief. And you know what's beautiful about that request? Is that he asked the right person. He said to Jesus, I believe, help my unbelief. He was asking the right person. Ask Jesus. Man, if right now you're struggling with faith because of Jerry's death, because of Jerry's passing, if you're wondering if there is a God, ask Jesus to help you believe. What is this faith that saves us? The goal of faith is to be accepted by God. And that's what we want. We want to be able to come to God knowing that we have nothing to offer Him except our hearts, except our lives, just as we are. That He will take this meager offering, as it says in Revelation chapter 3, I am pitiful, poor, blind, and naked. I have nothing to offer God except this. And that He will accept us and cover us with the grace of Christ. The passage from Galatians that Pastor John read speaks of what we can do to be accepted by God. And there was one verse that stood out, and one verse that made me think of Jerry. And that is this. We know that a person is not justified by works of the law. That is, not by customs, not by traditions, not what people expect of us, but through faith in Jesus Christ. In other words, nothing. Believing that in and of myself I can do nothing to please God because I'm a sinner, but believing that Jesus is enough to cover my debt, my sin, my lack. To be justified by faith alone, has been the cry of the church for 500 years since Martin Luther rediscovered it in this book, in the book of Galatians. Justified by faith, by the merit, by the work of Jesus Christ alone, not by my work, but by what Christ has done on the cross. All I need to do is trust Christ's promise. What is this faith that saves us? Assent, trust, surrender, commitment? It's faith. It is the initial and ongoing response that if you want to live at peace with God, you surrender to Him. William Barclay said, faith is the complete trust and complete surrender to Jesus Christ. It is the total acceptance of all that He said, all that He suffered, and all that He is. So, I'm going to go back on what I said now. There is a work that is required to please God and find acceptance with Him. And it's buried in these words. And some people, they ask Jesus, what kind of work should we do to be accepted by God? What kind of work does God like? And Jesus responded, this is the work of God, that you believe in Him whom He has sent. That's faith. Perhaps Jerry struggled to articulate his faith in eloquent words like a theologian or a pastor, perhaps. And maybe in Low German it would have come out better for him. Kost du dich rede? Yeah, who knows? Faith, you know, and I wondered, we were talking about Jerry and eternity, and I wonder if he isn't annoying the angels. Nerching them. Faith can be heard in different ways. I saw his faith expressed in many ways outside of words. I saw his faith in his willingness to accept me as his new pastor. He had a way of loving people, we have heard, and with his brand of humor and kibitzing. Many newcomers to Rosenort felt that acceptance from him, and as was told to me, it was his goal to love others when perhaps at times in his childhood he didn't always feel loved. I saw his faith in the fact that his family loves the Lord. You guys are amazing. Really. It's a joy to know you. And that heritage of faith is evident in the Friesen family. But you know, and we've heard this too, most telling was Jerry's faithfulness to his wife. And we've heard that, but I want to point out two things in his faithfulness to his wife, Nancy. When COVID kept him from being with her at the lodge in Morris, that normally light-hearted Jerry was perturbed. He was angry and just upset with the lockdown. He couldn't serve his wife as he had for the last 10 or so years. And even though she was confused, that's one word, keep that in mind, confused, and secondly, did not recognize, that's the second word, she was confused and did not recognize him anymore. He persisted in caring for her, being there every day. He was faithful to her, confused and did not recognize him. I believe that Jerry reflected the faithfulness of God to his wife, to his beloved. When we find ourselves confused in life and not knowing which way to turn, when our world is turned upside down and what used to make sense no longer does, and when dark clouds of sadness close in on us and threaten to choke our faith, choke it to such a degree that we just don't know what to believe about God anymore, God does not leave us. He is faithful to us in our confusion. And when we fail to recognize the face of God in our circumstances, God is faithful. When we cannot see His hand at work in our circumstances, He keeps working. And when we say, where is God? We don't know where we are. We don't know, even know what which way is up or down for ourselves. We're lost. God is faithful, never leaves us. For as Paul said, who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or sword or danger? No, none of these things shall separate us from the love of Christ. And nothing would separate Jerry from Nancy. As Jerry was faithful to Nancy, even when she did not know his face, God is even more faithful to us in the love of Christ. But what a reflection. Yes, Jerry imperfectly, yet persistently, reflected the commitment of God to those he loved. And God loved Jerry perfectly. Faith. It's not enough to say we believe in Jesus. Faith means living as best we can what Jesus has done for us, the Son of God. He died for sinners. How does that change you? How does that change the way you live? We decide to live in a way that honors that faithfulness, and I think Jerry did that very well. We know that a person is not justified by works of the law, but through faith in Jesus Christ. Scott McKnight writes, "Those who have been justified live justly. Those who have been made holy in Christ live holy lives. Those who have experienced God's love, love others. Those who have experienced God's forgiveness, forgive others. Those who have been called from the world no longer live in the world and call others to be out with them. And those who have died to the flesh live in the Spirit." Let us live in the Spirit. I say again, though imperfectly, in my flawed Deutsch, Jerry, ich liebe dich. You are a cool dude, and many of us will miss you. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, great God of love, you have poured out your love for us through Jesus Christ. We honor you in this. Thank you for giving us people like Jerry, who understood love, who understand it yet, and show it to us in their loving acceptance of whoever we are, speaking to us, even if we're in a foreign place, and finding a friend like Jerry wherever we are. We get a small glimpse of the love that you are having for us. Wherever we meet you, God, we can see a little bit of Jerry. We know that you're saying, "Tell me about yourself." God, we know you want to know us because you love us. So thank you for the honor of knowing Jerry. I pray for the peace and the power of Christ's presence to rest on the family as they grieve, as they miss him, as they go through many days that are going to be hard. I pray that they would rest on their faith in Jesus. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you, Daryl, for those words. Jerry would be very pleased. I'll invite you to stand if you are able for this closing song. Beautiful song of hope, because he lives.
To love. our close. Here.
This brings to a close the service where we have sought to honor the life that Jerry lived and to bring glory to our Lord Jesus Christ. Jerry lived his life in faith and obedience to our Lord Jesus. Thank you again for coming to support the family and to encourage them in this way. It has made their day much easier. And I want to say for the announcements, everybody is invited to a fellowship in the lower auditorium where refreshments and coffee will be served. Please give the family time to transition to the lower auditorium first, and then the ushers will come to direct you when it's your turn to exit here. And so once the family is out, you can be seated, and then the ushers will later on come and direct you. Now let's pray. Our gracious God and Heavenly Father, we thank you so much. You have ministered words of hope to the family. You have ministered words of hope to us. And we're so grateful that we have such a glorious Savior who invites us to fellowship with him and then invites us to our eternal home to be with you. And that's where Jerry is right now. And we praise you for that. May you continue to encourage and comfort the family in the coming days. As we partake of the refreshments later, we pray, Lord, that you will just strengthen our bodies through the food, and may we be a blessing and encouragement to the family and to each other. Now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of the Father, and the fellowship of his Holy Spirit be with each one. Amen.
I could see.